Hey, I'm Frida Wolf, and this is the Codec. Hey, I'm Lorraine, and this is the Codec. Callum!
What is up, ladies and gentlemen? Welcome back to the Codec. Today we have a special guest. I hope I'm gonna pronounce your name right. Is it Freda? Frida Wolf. Welcome to the show. How are you doing today? Thank you for coming. We have a ton of fans here from different games, a lot obviously from Mass Effect, but we have some other fans who are a fan of some of your other games that you have out there. So let's start off by telling anybody who might not know who you are and how you kind of got started in voice acting.
And I had a career in video games for 12 years. I got my foot in the door when I was a little 18-year-old grunt with EverQuest as the game master and did that for 2.5 years. And then eventually they opened up a sound department and then I got the opportunity to be a sound designer. That's quite a leap. Like at the time, this is back early 2000s. So before a lot of people were born, it was at the time the most ambitious game for dialogue because they were shooting for at least 100,000 lines of dialogue, which is more than anybody had done, and literally everyone in LA and beyond got recorded, including casting directors. It was like people still have PTSD from that game. And that gave me the opportunity to just get my foot in the door as a grunt for just implementing VO, but I had no prior audio experience. And then when that dried up, someone, a lead, mentored me very generously. I got to be a sound designer, and I was a sound designer for the majority of my career. And then I rolled over into VO because when you're an audio person, being in front of the mic and doing temp VO for Scratch or for Creatures or whatever is just part of the job. So it's a really natural transition. And then also, oftentimes audio people like me get to be privy to scheduling and casting and actually sitting, co-directing. Like you usually have, a booth director, your booth slash casting director, who's the actor whisperer, is in the sessions with you, but they usually want at least one dev there for things like pronunciation or context or whatever the casting, you know, the booth director might not be entirely aware of. And so I got to do a lot of that throughout my career. So I started coming up to LA. Like I've kind of crawled up the coast. I started in San Diego and then lived in Irvine. That's where Blizzard is. For a while. And so it was just like an hour plus round trip to do nights and weekends for fun. I thought it'd be useful to do VO classes and improv classes and stuff because that stuff as a hobby is fun.
Right.
And I did that for 4 years consistently. And because it wasn't weighted on me with the pressure of, I got to make this work. I got to make money. I got to be an actor. I got to make it. I think that served me really well because I treated it like a hobby. So when I rolled over from games into VO, it was like, oh, well, shoot, I've been doing this for 4 years. I have a 4-year education of just being involved in the community. I think I know what I'm doing. So I just got demos made and started working right away. But I do think a lot of that just has to do with the fact that, which, by the way, I should say I was really cocky out of the gate and was like, I know everything about VO because I've been involved in the video game pipeline, which is a bunch of garbage. Because when you're, first of all, when you're an actor, like, you know, you are the first of Mass Effect related community interviews that I'm doing. Cool. Yeah. And adorably, a lot of people are like putting out YouTube videos and Twitter threads and whatever, where they're like, leave your questions here for her. And I've seen a few that are so cute where they're like, so what attracted you to the role? Like, what about it made you decide to accept it? That was just like really, what did you think was cool? And I'm like, oh, that's cute. You think we pick and choose. When you're an actor, you're signing up for whoever's willing to give you money.
Yeah, right.
You do and it doesn't,
a bunch of auditions a day.
It does not matter what you're like, whatever your last, and it doesn't matter what medium you work in, whether you're a voice actor or on camera, it doesn't matter what your last film or TV show or whatever. Once you're off the project, you're out of a job again and you have to audition. And people are only maybe going to judge you if they remember you or cared at all about your last project, but it's completely irrelevant to your next job. So in voice acting, you have to do stuff like commercials and promos and all the other less fun, less exciting, maybe less artistically fulfilling stuff.
Yeah.
Because it pays the bills. Like, video games notoriously pay the least out of all the union contracts.
Which is ridiculous.
It's ridiculous, but also, so we're in this weird, it doesn't matter who you talk to in production right now, we're in this weird Wild West phase, because in the last 10 years, streaming has become the overwhelming majority platform. Yeah. And what's broken about that is, whereas before, like, if you were on commercial, a television show, film or whatever, whenever that would go to broadcast, that's when you would get your back in residuals and stuff, so your secondary payments.
Yeah.
But there's no metric like that for non-broadcast, meaning streaming services. So like any television show that only lives on Netflix or only lives on Hulu or only lives on Amazon Prime, those actors have to negotiate essentially buyout prices up front because they're never gonna see residual backends because those programs are never gonna go to broadcast. So that logic applies to video games where it's like these things are never gonna go to broadcast. Like Mass Effect will not go into syndication and run on TBS at 3 a.m. That's not a thing. So as a result, it's sort of like, you know, when you negotiate for a salary for a job and you have to go in with like, what am I going to roll over out of bed every morning and be okay with for the next 3 years before I get my next job or promotion? It's the same thing. If you don't negotiate out the gate something that's going to make you happy long term, you're kind of stuck with what you're stuck with. So games with, like, you know, the strike being prescient and all that, with the last contract being negotiated in 94, 95, and then like people not seeing the future of like, well, you know, TV and film's not going to be a thing because people are going to release their films directly to streaming.
Yeah.
And not have box office numbers, and you're not going to have, like, television won't matter for television. I don't know why we're still calling it TV, et cetera. So anyway, I was like, for me personally, obviously, especially I think because I come from production, I tend to be much more business focused because it's just weird. It's so much in flux right now. Yeah. It's so broke. So like, you talk to anybody, doesn't matter, like editors, anybody in the pipeline of just media and television is like, we don't know what's going to happen. Yeah, it's just kind of happening.
Scary out there.
Well, it's just like, it's just essentially people have to figure out and renegotiate those initial payments of like, well, this is what I want you to pay me as a contract person for your project, because I have to think about how I'm not going to get money down the line.
Yeah. Which is, you know, something up in the air right now with that strike that you mentioned. I believe they're trying to negotiate for you guys to get another session fee if the game sells like X amount of copies or something like that, which you know, makes perfect sense in the eyes of somebody, you know, outside of that. But you know, as you said, obviously there's a lot of different opinions on, you know, how things are broadcasted and presented and sales numbers and all of that kind of stuff. So I can see how, you know, while you're doing something fun like recording, you know, crazy characters and voices and stuff like that, you do have to have your commercial stuff and, like, as you said, then some non-artistic type of things to make sure that you eat tomorrow, kind of.
Yeah, it's just to pay the bills. Like, post-strike, a lot of hilarious articles went out about, like, they make $800 for 4 hours of work and they want more? Shut up. And it's like, well, okay, so first of all,
you gotta think of the scope. I made a video about this recently, and the scope of, you know, you guys have to come in and add so much in your little bit of time frame, but it's just as important to the game as somebody who's been working on it for a year getting paid an hourly wage to make the game. You've gotta kinda make that's somewhere similar to that amount within the time frame that you're working on the game.
Kind of, sort of. So people forget just basic economics. Like, for example, a gross payment is not what you end up with after taxes, after 8-10%. So, like, the net gain I get from a gross of the $850, whatever it is, for 4-hour union session is, like, depending on my withholding at the time and then all the other stuff that goes into it, it's anywhere as high as, like, I think I've seen $640, as low as, like, $480.
Oh, man.
So that's the net, first of all.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, like, I actually, you know, as I have a very much a – I did – freelance audio for a while, so I got a taste, and a lot of sound people are freelance, not in-house. Yeah. So you get a taste of what it is to be an independent business owner and be responsible for your taxes and stuff. So I have savings set aside just to pay my taxes, because a lot of companies can't be bothered to use what's called a paymaster, and they're the people who figure out your withholding and stuff.
Yeah.
So I get paid in gross. So I have to be like, okay, well, that's not real money. That's money I have to pay in April. Goodbye, money. So yeah. So anybody who's a, you know, a contractor, independent business owner understands that, that when you get paid, it's like, well, it's not real money. It's all ethereal, going to the IRS later.
I'm a contractor as well, so I know all,
yeah,
all about that. So let's talk a little bit about something that you actually kind of schooled me on this week. And that is one of your first game credits on IMDb is PlanetSide, which is pretty cool. That game was amazing. Can you tell us the story about what happened? Because it was kind of interesting how you explained it on Twitter, how you recorded, but it didn't go through. And
well, that's a perfect example. So, and I think, like, let me look at the year. I've got my IMDb up too, so I know what the heck I've done and what I can talk about. So at that point, I was still, my video game career started as like, and I'm the last generation that got away with it, because now there's so many schools and institutes and vocational. So now, like, you're almost expected to be a millennial with a degree. I was the last generation that learned on the job, and it was trial by fire. Also because, like, back in my day, you could not pay a subscription or get Unity for free or Unreal for free. Like, that didn't exist. The only way to get your hands on licenses and get real world experience was to get in the door. So my career was 2.5 years of being, you know, customer service game master for EverQuest, and then a year being for a tech VP's assistant, where he was like, you're being wasted and I don't know what to do with you. I'm like, me neither. And then audio department was formed, and that just made perfect sense for me. So looking at the timeline, if I remember what happened, they were like, Sony Online was like, can we just hold auditions? We just need a tutorial, and it's just VO. VO is not a big deal. Let's just still hold auditions to see if someone in-house can just do the tutorial. And me being just like a little cocky squirt was like, yeah! So I auditioned, and I obviously have some sort of innate ability to do this. This is before me doing audio at all. And so they like hired me, cheap in-house labor, so they wouldn't have to pay me any extra. And the tutorial was like anybody who knows, hours and hours and hours and hours of work, and me being brand new, never having done VO before, I was probably not as hard, fast, and efficient a machine as I am now.
Right.
I was in there with one of the lead designers for hours. We might have done those 8 hours a day. I really doubt. I don't think we did 4 hours stuff, because again, this is all just off the cuff. This is very garage now that I think about it. And it was fine. I did the best I could for a little whatever I was, 20, 21 year old. And then the game went gold. So again, back in my day, once the game went gold, everything was in hard copy, because it was then going to be shipped to retailers in box form, pre-patching and stuff, pre-digital download, because we were still running on brand new cable.
Yeah.
I'm old. and then after gold, they last minute hired a professional, which I believe was Wendy Lee. But because it had already gone gold, she didn't make it to credits. So I got the credit for her work, which is not fair, because Wendy Lee is a very established professional woman who's been around a billion years. So that's the story of that credit. It's totally, it's a giant lie that cracks me up. But that's the result of just, back
still
in the day.
Yeah, it's interesting to hear.
Well, back in the day, if you roll back enough, And rightfully so, if you put in YouTube worst video game voice performances, most of those are, designers, programmers, people's friends and relatives and wives and husbands and boyfriends, and it's a hot mess. You get what you pay for.
Definitely, yeah. It's becoming ever more clear as, stuff like the strike happens. There's a lot of controversy, I think, when it comes to it, because I think a lot of people, maybe who are very casual game players, don't realize that a lot of times the voice acting can make or break the entire game. If you've got, somebody who just doesn't embody or voice that role correctly or doesn't sound right. I use this example all the time. I mean, if you play games and you've played Metal Gear, it just would not be the same if it wasn't David Hayter, voicing Snake. It just wouldn't. And it's very clear, because we had somebody just recently, Kiefer Sutherland, voice Snake in the new Metal Gear that came out last year, and it just wasn't the same. I mean, he wasn't bad or anything, but it's just not the same. So, that's kind of the point of our show, is to just show the quality and the things that you get when you have professional voice actors, you know, lending their voice to the games.
It just helps. I mean, worst case scenario, you mute the game, right? Or you're like me and you just, you know, click and skip and skip and skip, and then you scream bloody murder when there's an unskippable cutscene and you get up and make a sandwich because you're like, F you, I'm not watching this. That's me. Like, I've had, just again, adorably, the Mass Effect community is just guessably non-aggro and really warm and cuddly.
Yeah,
and just the other thing that I've seen a lot besides, like, so what attracted you to picking the role with the just, you know, hanging around on your throne waiting for things to, like, phone calls to land on your lap? The other one was, so what's your favorite Mass Effect character romance fight scene weapon? And it's like, girl, I hate RPGs so much. I looked at Steam, I've played 79 minutes of Mass Effect, and that's the second time I picked it up. The first time I lasted 20 minutes because I couldn't find, like, I hate adventure games too. I'll only play adventure games like Studio Amanita, which is this tiny Czech Republic studio that makes incredible games like Machinarium and Botanicula. They've
so
got
you
a
do
new
play
one.
Some games.
I'm a gamer, I gotta be. But like adventure games, I'll play with a walkthrough, and only, you know, for exceptions, for like if I really like the art or audio, like Amanita games. With RPGs, I just avoid them because I'm a murder hobo, and I just there to murder and loot and level up and murder and loot and level. I don't get asked back to D&D. I'm really bad about it. So like if you wanna, so just like series like Mass Effect just have too much dialogue, which I realize how roiling in irony that is when it's. Yeah. My job. So,
right.
But I think
sometimes you got to separate. You know, if you do that for a living, you might not want to, you know, do that in your leisure time.
100%. So, a really big to do that you'll hear a lot, and this isn't just voiceover. I think like I'm constantly making analogies between just the way you live your life and the way you approach dating or personal relationships.
Right.
You can't want it when you are needy and desperate for whatever it is, for love, affection, for a relationship, for a job. You're repugnant. It's disgusting. It just like reeks off of you, and people are repelled by your gross neediness. Versus when you just don't care and you're just doing you, and you walk into a room like you don't need to be there, but like, okay, well, I'll make 5 minutes for you. What do you got? You have to approach auditions the same way. In the same way, like if you go to an interview and you're sweating because you're like, I really need this job. You know, just like, I really need this job. And it's just like, nobody else loves me. Just please give me this job. You're not going to get the job. Versus if you go in cool, collected, calm, whatever. Yeah. So with auditions, the first thing a lot of people tell you is like, you can't want it. You cannot want it. If you get something for like, and I feel it too. So like when I get, like right now we're in the age of like a lot of animated reboots, like Voltron.
Yeah.
So like a lot of licenses are coming back, right? For people our age.
It's funny. We just had, oh my God, Josh Keaton on the show from Voltron.
Oh, he's a really nice boy. He's a nice dad. Shiro dad is, space dad is nice. He's a sweetheart. I've met him like once or twice, but we've like been in a couple of things where they schedule us at different times. I'm like, just missed you again because we work, you know, in a little box by ourselves talking to no one. So you can't want it. So when I get these scripts for like, for example, like reboots that I grew up with, I immediately, like, I'll put it off until I'm going to do a bad job because I'm just like in a cold sweat. I'm like, I can't do it. It's too much pressure. I don't even know. And also like for me, because I'm attached to it emotionally, I have a really difficult time thinking what else can I do with it, because I'm already like married to what was done, which is not good, which is not going to serve me, which means I'm not going to get the job. So when you get something, which by the way, like, I don't know if it's like all EA auditions, but a lot of them, EA and some other companies will put out like repeat blanket auditions that are just like dummy scripts.
Right.
Where they're not even... They haven't even like changed the names and the terms and the settings. It's just like they've been putting out the same scripts for years because they're just looking to see, can you be a human? Can you be a believable person in a scene? Can you do it? Great, you're hired. And they'll do that for years where you're like, I've already done this, but you can't think that, right? You're just like, all right, I'll try something else till something lands. So you can't want it. So I think, I mean, I remember specifically which one I did to get Andromeda, and I was really annoyed with it because it was very long. And I was like really resentful. I'm like, this is so long. This is like gonna be 3 minutes edited together. Don't they know I have other things to do? And then I booked and I was like, I'm never gonna complain about script length ever again. Yeah, right. I am a brat.
I would imagine that you know, the going in and voicing for a Mass Effect game, there pretty much is probably not one other game. Maybe Fallout would be close to the amount of dialogue that you're gonna have to, you know, read through. So
calling it boot camp isn't accurate or hardcore enough, but I mean, I'll say that just like coming out the other end of this, anybody who's ever done a BioWare game just immediately has my unconditional respect.
Right? I bet.
It is like,
they pay
it is
so
like
good attention to their story. So many side dialogues and things like that.
Jesus. Like the way they run their sessions and everything is just, I think, exemplary for the industry.
That's awesome to hear. Now, I want to talk about, there's a couple of games on your, I guess, resume that are kind of like indie hits. Like, you've been in a couple of games that are sold very well and are very popular within the indie crowd. Is there any way, like, when you book a game, for instance, let's talk about Killer Instinct for a second. When you book a game, is there anything that kind of stands out to you when you're reading the script or when you're performing in the indie world that says, okay, this game is going to be pretty good, or at least this game has a better leg up than something that you have done previously?
Well, you can kind of, I think even if you don't have the full context of a game or story, you can tell when a script is stinky or not. Like, you can tell if someone's got funny, clever, punny, interesting lines, or right. Like, or if it's just, they haven't really tried anything beyond, grenade, come at me, I'll murder you. And then it's like, okay, another one of these, which you do anyway, because you want money.
Right, of course.
But you can always kind of tell when something's just given some effort. Just like with anything, you don't know, like, just, again, to compare with on-camera actors, like, you don't know if the pilot that you got that actually got approved is going to make it past the season. You hold on for dear life and hope for the best. With stuff like Killer Instinct, that was just randomly that audition landing in my lap because it was a Latin American kind of character with an accent. Like, I'm half Mexican and I speak Spanish fluently, and my party trick is not having an accent in either language. Which, as a result, means I get cast a lot as someone having a Latina accent of some kind. And Brazilian is not far off. And okay. Mira's Brazilian. It's very, very similar. So that ends up happening a bunch. I am so sorry, as a cat owner, for people who understand I have cat problems, the cat wants out.
Yeah,
if you need a second.
Go for
it. Apologies to all the dog people who don't get it, but whatever.
They're important. If you guys are enjoying the show, be sure to give us a follow. Hit that blue button on your bar there. And if you have any questions that aren't spoiler related, you can submit those in the chat as well. Welcome back. How are you doing?
I'm back.
Cat good?
If everybody sees me on Twitter, I have a hashtag Daily Hoggle because I have this fat, enormous, gray, 18-pound beast.
I saw it. I
did. Who's just kind of always belly up and yelling at me.
I've had to keep my cat out of the room because there's as I said, we've been doing this show, this is our second year now. There's been multiple times where, you know, I'm interviewing voice actors that, you know, people only dream of interviewing, and the cat's jumping up on the table, and I'm like,
oh yeah,
okay, you're not allowed to be in here when I'm doing my show anymore.
No, so. It's worth, if I, well, with Hoggle, if I shut him out of a room I'm at, he thinks I'm dead or need a rescue mission. And he'll immediately start yelling and then playing footsies. It's the most, like, if I'm in the bathroom, I've just started leaving a shoe by the door. So he, you know, he thinks he's interacting with me or something. So he's slightly less panicky.
Right.
It's just, he's not a St. Bernard, but he tries.
Right. So you have another game that I'd like to talk about just briefly. This one is kind of a silly game. And I just wanted to know if you had any, differences with the role. You were in Octodad and you played a bunch of like side characters as well as Stacy, the main, I guess, Octodad's wife.
Literally every woman except the mom, and the credit is every woman, and then Tom Taylorson is literally every man, including Octodad, so, except the son, and the mother and the son are both Anne Sonneville, the same lady.
A lot of people obviously are going to draw the connection. You have Tom here, you here, and then you guys both in Mass Effect. Can you tell us a little bit about Octodad, how it was recording for a quirky, weird game like that, and Did that maybe have any impact on you guys becoming involved in Mass Effect as a like a duo?
First of all, to our knowledge, BioWare and EA had no clue whatsoever that they were both hiring Octo people. And it was really funny because the way Tom and I figured out, like, Tom, so the Octodad guys, Young Horses, are out in Chicago.
Yeah.
They were, Octodad is, the ship game is the second iteration of their student final project from school because they're little baby geniuses. Yep. It was originally a project of, like, 12, 20-year-olds who then incorporated to 9 24-year-olds and decided to stick it out, and they made Octodad. Yeah. Most of them living in the same apartment, working nights and weekends while they were holding down full-time jobs.
Right.
And paying, and, like, they, you know, they had, like, a weenie Kickstarter because they didn't really understand, like, how much they were really going to need for licenses and just cost of living and stuff like that. Right. So, I mean, there's a lot of sweat, tears, and blood in that game. And they knew Tom because Tom, they were from DePaul University in Chicago. Tom was teaching classes there. And Chicago has obviously pretty vibrant actor community. A lot of commercials, some television, not a lot of VO. Tom's been doing audiobooks and stuff and the like out there. But he was mostly getting his VO kicks through some commercial promo work, which, again, like, that's throughout the United States. All the creative stuff is mostly based out of L.A. But getting to do, there's a program in DePaul where you can work with union actors as a student at a really cut rate, but you get the experience of working with actors. Yeah. So that's how Tom ended up becoming the Octodad. I got involved with Octodad only because I have a big mouth, and I was on Twitter, and I just randomly one day said, I'm so hopeful for the next generation of indie games, because there's all these kids in their early 20s who have no... They have no trauma from working at a real developer. They've never been in-house, so no one's told them what they can't do.
Yeah.
No one's told them what they can't do. So I said, I'm just really excited for games like Viscera Cleanup Detail and Papers, Please, and Octodad. And within, like, 5 minutes, Phil Tipitowski, who's the president of Young Horses, just emailed me, and he's like, hey, I'm sorry, this is... creepy, but it's you weird. Said something nice on Twitter, and then we went to your website, and would you like to audition for our game? And I was like, okay, I guess this is how we do business now. And the rest is history. So the way I found out with Tom moved from Chicago to Los Angeles, I want to say summer of 2015, and we were trying to hang out and have lunch, and he was like, hey, I'm going to be in Burbank this day, this time. And I was like, I'm also going to be in Burbank around this day. What studio are you recording? He's like, this studio. I'm like, huh, let's play a game. The game is called Are We on the Same Game? And he's like, and I was like, is it in space? And he's like, yeah. And I was like, oh, well, I have bad news for you. I'm the player character. And he's like, no, I'm the player character. I was like, what?
That's such a great story. I love that.
Yeah. And, like, you know, obviously we're under NDA and all that stuff, but we're just like, but the thing is, like, the community is so small, and we see, because we work in solitary, you either, like, see the next person coming in behind us, or it's like, oh, you're on this thing too.
Yeah.
And obviously, like, we can't talk about it publicly on social media, but you start to get an inkling of who else is on your project with you. So for us, just finding out casually like that was like, shut up, shut up. And they had, like, BioWare had no idea. Like, we mentioned it. Once they told us to let us know that we could know that each of us were in it, we were like, by the way, did you know? And they were like, no, that's weird. Why would you bring that up? And we're like, I don't know. Why did you? So yeah. And then I do love that the community has been like, and Clancy Brown is Mr. Krabs. So apparently Andromeda is crustacean themed.
Yeah,
and I have nothing to do with it.
That's amazing. What kind of topic I want to talk about, and feel free to pass on this if you want to. It's a little controversial, but I figured I'd ask. You did some work on a game that didn't really get off the ground. It's called Dawn Gate. Do you remember recording for this game?
Yeah, that was some of my favorite. It was just, I only did 1 4-hour session for it, but it was some of my favorite writing still to date. Chris Latois, who's still... who I just, like, chased down to write him love letters because it was so good. Because he worked on Mass Effect 2, I believed. I believe he's a Mass Effect 2 guy.
Okay.
Gosh. So, I mean, after League of Legends, there is still, like, this influx of MOBAs, and it's really hard to prove why your MOBA is different. Like, yeah. you know, like a lot of people try to make WoW killers.
Exactly.
It's like, okay, yeah. well, how is your MMO a different MMO? So unless you do something like Mike's husband is a character 3D modeler character lead on Heroes of the Storm, so I get to be privy to that development. And with like Heroes of the Storm, they were just like, okay, what can we do that is not League? Very, very so like very purposefully, what do we like and not like about League, and how can we do it different? So like you cannot compare those two games, even though they're essentially, you know, they're both MOBAs. So with Dawngate, unfortunately, I think there just maybe wasn't enough differentiation between what it offered that was different. Because just visually, if you just did like, you know, a quick sweep over, if you're looking at trailers and stuff and whatever, yeah. and if you weren't like looking at mechanics, you're just kind of like, eh. Right. So
it's a shame too, because like you said, the characters were written pretty good.
Oh
my
god!
I enjoyed the characters.
Oh my god! So the art's really good, but the writing. So my character, like Tess, was this freaking Italian accented wily sky pirate. It was sort of like the Alana Glazer of the skies, if you watch Broad City. She, like, the writing was so specific. So they had all this triggered in-game stuff where if my character was around any number of combinations of other characters, one or two or three, it would trigger up, like I said, like, of course this would come from a Mass Effect writer. dialogue branches that would talk about their past relationships. That one's my ex. I hate that one. I'm jealous of that one. That one's involved with my current lover. So my character was like this crazy, not crazy. It's just like she just broke a lot of video game mold and stereotypes where she was just like very sex positive, forward thinking, I think bisexual, open relationship.
She was a hoot, I tell you.
Swinging balls around. Like if you look up, I've got the art up on my site, but like she had like a bomber with this awesome beefcake bear dude as the cheesecake decal on it. It's just adorable.
Yeah.
Like they just did all this awesome typical gender role reversal on her where she just basically got to swing her dick a lot.
Right.
And be cool and just be kind of like basically like almost like a Captain Jack Sparrow but sober.
Yeah.
A little more sober. Which again you just don't really get to see very often because I think, especially when you've got, you know, kudos to Chris Letoit being able to put himself in the mindset of something other than a hetero white male, which I know he works very hard to do. because a hetero white male, like, you write what you know or what you desire. You're just projecting what you want to see in the world, right? So very commonly, that's where you end up with, like, damsel in distress tropes and, like, the woman as reward tropes where they're not, like, active participants. They're just there to kind of, like, fluff the men. So, and from what I saw of Dawngate, like, I got little fan groups off of Dawngate, just in the beta, because people were so just, like, enamored and loyal about those characters. So, like, that community is really nice. I'm kind of grateful to them because they kind of stuck around. We're like, I don't know what else you're going to do, but the character was fun. I'm like, I know! The character was a hoot.
Yeah, I was kind of disappointed when the game shut down, like I said, just because it did have some good character development. I didn't get a chance to, like, check them all out. That's the bad thing about, you know, MOBAs and that free-to-play aspect is, you know, you don't get to experience everything. So with Dawngate, there wasn't a whole lot of time to experience all of the different, like, interactions and things that you're, mentioning. But there's another game that just recently closed, Evolve, that you did some voice work for as well. Is there anything going into these like free-to-play games that require like the community to support when you're approaching it as a voice actor that you're ever hesitant about, or do you just take it because, as we talked about earlier, you got to eat?
Well, as a community, well, free-to-play is just like not sustainable anymore, I think, because of market saturation. Because there were a few, like, look, in the beginning of this era from the last 10 years when you can make a mobile game and maybe become a multimillionaire and be bought up by Zynga, and you can make a free-to-play MOBA or what have you. I mean, that is a 10-year-old business model where you would do be dependent on, or like even 10 to 15-year-old business model where you would do microtransactions and you'd be fine. There's just too many. So obviously that just the market's just depleted and people, it's just like with streaming services, like not everyone can afford to subscribe to everything. You pick your pony, yeah, and you stick with it and hope for the best. So I think it's just too much to ask for. I think people should go back to just like an MSRP, you know, price like so a lot too. Of people have. It's just because just get.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back. Sorry for the inconvenience there. Windows 10 apparently doesn't agree to this interview. They shut us down.
My blue screen of death from the ever so considerate Windows 10 said, Frida, you need a pee break right now. Right now in the middle of whatever you were saying, you should go. You should just go. So I just went.
In any case, we were getting towards the end of our conversation on these free-to-play games and how a couple of them that you voiced some pretty cool characters in. I mean, Evolve is the one we were talking about just now. That character as well, kind of like Dawngate, was pretty cool. It's a pretty neat little character. The concept of the game was good. It just relied too much on the free-to-play aspect. They had like skin packs for everything and everything. Like there was like two different types of like DLC, and one didn't cover the other, and the season pass didn't include this. It was just way too much for gamers, and it's such a shame because some of these characters, as with Dawngate and Evolve, are really cool characters, and you spend obviously time to prep, and you know, you go in and you do these sessions, and you know, I'm sure you can tell us a little bit about it, but some of them are pretty strenuous when you're having to do, you know, screams and you know, like you're getting eaten by a monster in the case of Evolve, or maybe you're doing like a battle charge in Dawngate. They can be pretty strenuous on the voice, and it's got to be at least a little bit of a shame to see some of them, you know, die out like that.
Yeah, part and parcel. I mean, like the yelling and screaming stuff, that's part and parcel of doing games. But you do, like, as far as vocal protection, there's got to be some compromise between if you don't get a booth director who's seasoned and experienced and kind and doesn't write it like a nag, you have to stick up for yourself as a voice actor, which unfortunately some people, like if they're really new and naive and they haven't talked to anybody about how a session should go, they might put up with stuff like screaming at the start rather than leaving it for the end. Because there, I've seen people very naively be like, cool, let's do all this yelling, death, damage, burning, and then we'll do some intimate dialogue, monologue stuff. And we're like, are you insane? Because they don't understand that it's a finite resource. Like, they forget. You know how you were out at a concert and you were yelling, or at a bar, and the next day you sound like you have sexy cold? That's a thing that affects voice actors. We're not, you know, impenetrable. Just like with everything's a fashion, right? And games come and go with fashion.
Right.
Whether it's by genre or the franchise itself or whatever, they have their moment and then they bleh. And if they're gonna bleh sooner than later, like, not everyone's gonna have the standing power of like the era of MMOs, for example. That was not a new profitable gold mine. That's a mine that had a finite amount of gold to mine, and we're done now. So I don't know. Like, just my contractor brain is always like, get the money up front. Just get, like, you know, like when you go to the store, you're not like, I'm gonna take this ham and I'm gonna sample it for like the first three levels, and if I like it, I might pay you for like a quarter of the ham. Also, could I get the ham done up Hawaiian style differently? Maybe I'll pay $10 for that, but I'm still not gonna pay you for what it costs to process this ham. That's nonsense math.
Yeah, exactly.
It's just Swiss cheese garbage math that doesn't hold up your production cycle. So yeah, I still think it's hard to beat getting your money up front, for whether you are a service provider or selling a product.
Right.
Because you can't, it's just like that whole, like, you know how we're going through this phase where people are having to wake up and get a little smarter. And so you have so many like feeds on Tumblr and Twitter where they post people doing, asking for work for exposure. And it's like, well, I can't pay my rent in exposure. I can't pay the dentist in exposure.
No, you cannot.
And I can't buy cat food in exposure. So maybe no. So yeah, same thing with games. I think, I don't know. I'm happy to see that like turn back. I know gamers don't like it because nobody likes paying for anything. But
I think really the problem is, I think games right now, they're a little more expensive than they probably should be. We were just doing a show last week, and we were recapping some of these some of these games. There's a game right now you can buy. I'm pretty sure it's Watch Dogs 2, and their top edition is like $159. Like, a game just really shouldn't cost that much, regardless of like the extra in-game items and stuff. And we took away, that was the top tiered one. The second one was like $70. It was like $69.99, and all it included. Below the $159 one and the regular base one at $59.99 with some in-game like items, some hats and some things like that. And let's say you buy two games in a month, that's a lot of money. That's a ton of money. But then you see other games that are just as good, i.e. Masquerada, which is a great game, by the way. We're going to talk a little bit more about the process of that in a second. But it's a great game, and it's not overpriced. There's a lot of content there. There's a lot of stuff to do. Obviously, the production values with the voice actors is just insanely good. It's a lot of fun to play, and it doesn't, you know, break your arm, you know. And that's kind of what I see is I feel like Call of Duty or somewhere, one of those games, those high-tiered, high-budget games came out and said, okay, this game's $60. So now, since it sold very well, everybody's like, okay, every game has to cost $60. And it really doesn't have to be like that. And I think Masquerade is a great...
We're in a pickle because part of it is marketing, right? So, like, people don't think twice to spend that much money on the, quote, collector's edition. Because they're like, oh, well, it's not the base product. Look at all this other stuff I'm getting for my money. Yeah, that's money well spent. It's a collector's edition. Of course, I'm going to buy it. Versus if you call that, well, that's now the base price for the game, and you don't call it something special, your psychology prevents you from letting it be okay. So you're like, oh, no, that's too much for the product, even though I totally would have bought it if you called it collector's edition. Yeah. In the same way, we're like, if you talk to anybody at Valve, anytime there's a Steam sale, that's when they make, it's something like, it's insane. It's like 3 or 6 times more money on profits than sales throughout the year at the regular price. Yeah. They make their money back because they call it a sale. Or you call anything, it's a limited edition coffee. I gotta have it. It's limited edition. So, like, human psychology justifies a lot of crap when it comes to spending. Yeah. So part of it is marketing. And the other part is, like, I think we're also in a pickle where consumers will try to quantify how much a game is worth. And so, like, so I don't know how many other actors do this, but I'm a total creep, and when something I'm in comes out, I will squat on as many Twitch streams as I can, just seeing people's, you know, like, first couple of nights reactions and stuff for fun. So I hear everything, the good, the bad, cool, whatever
though. No, I haven't heard that very much.
It's just like a free, you know, like react feedback service to do. Yeah, and I get to be a creep. And I've sat in chats, just to prove nobody cares about the voice actors. I'll sit in chats and, like, give pro tips or comment while the credits are rolling, and, like, you know, the 40 to 12 year old will be like, yeah, whatever, but my name just scrolled by. They don't care. Nobody cares. So with the park I think, like, was $20 US, and yeah, what I got a lot of in Twitch streams. So people, I don't think it's the most polarizing game, but some people who got it thinking that it was going to be like a schlocky, campy horror fest, where they were saying stuff like, I quote, this doesn't have enough jump scares for $20. This is like $5 worth of jump scares. And I'm like, oh, I'm sorry. I didn't know there was a quota at which you can mark price points based on jump scares. That's different. That's interesting. Stuff like that. Or they're like, there was not enough gore in this game for it to be. That's not $20 worth of
that's
gore.
That's crazy. I liked the park. I thought it was cool.
But, like, people who went in, maybe not with, like, a quota marker for, like, this has this many references to death and this many mentions of violence, so they could feel like they got their money's worth. Like, a lot of people played the park and ended it in tears, especially like, so me, I'm 34 and I don't have kids. I have cats, and I've noticed as I've gotten older, media hits parents much differently.
Yeah.
So a lot of, and not necessarily, like, I also saw, like, just a lot of, like, like 25-year-old dudes rocking back and forth and, like, in tears, being like, I don't know what just happened, but this has really affected me, and I think I need to call my mom. Which was adorable. But, like, that game affected parents very, very deeply. And I got a lot of, like, people coming out of the work on Twitter being just like, I just want to thank you because it just really affected me. And I just wanted to go hug my son and cry for an hour. And it's like, oh, man, that's intense.
Yeah.
And they felt they got their money's worth because it sort of Like, in the same way where if you pay, you know, $15 or whatever to go see a movie, you expect to have an experience of some kind. Doesn't right. have to be a big epic adventure. Just you expect to feel something, which is why we give money to anything, because it's just like, I'm buying this album. Make me feel something, please.
Yeah, I think that's a good. I think it's a great point, because you do have a lot of people that I guess are judging games like that, and we tend, and when I say we, I'm speaking on behalf of some of my co-hosts as well. We tend to kind of judge our games by like length, and I didn't really think about, you know, kind of the aspects of what you're saying is, you know, who's to say how long a game should be. Is if the story is delivered correctly, it can be maybe an hour and a half or 2 hours, as opposed to maybe something like The Witcher or Mass Effect, which is, you know, 100+ hours.
Well, it's arbitrary consumer logic. Like, when you go see a Michael Bay film, do you ask for your money back because you got 5 less explosions than you expected?
No.
Like,
no.
Right? I mean, in fact, you might actually, you know, actually feel you got your money's worth because you got 5 explosions less for once.
Okay.
So you could enjoy the few explosions that you had.
Yeah, right. That's great. And I think, you know, to talk a little bit more about the part, can you tell us maybe like when you're recording something that has maybe a little less or a little more emotional depth and more stuff behind the story than maybe something that you've done previous, such as, I don't know, like you were the narrator in Civilization, which was great, by the way. But when you're doing the different roles, do you ever have to kind of dive more deeply into the story and the lines that you're doing with something like The Park as opposed to something like Civilization, or do you just tackle it as what's written on the paper?
So the way acting works, and this is like also like a kind of a recent revelation, because I've only been doing VO, it'll be 4 years in April of next year, so it's like we're at 3.5 years right now, me doing it. And I make my anniversary when I got an agent, because that's when you get access to the big projects. I'd been doing it for money, but like small scale, tiny non-union stuff, and like the keys to the corporate ladder are definitely through agents. So just like pro tip, if you're doing it, you can't make it a full-time living until you have an agent, just because of what the money you can make versus cost of living wherever you are. So bad acting is pretending. If it's fake for me, it's fake for you, and it's bad. And unless you're being called to do hammy, over-the-top soap opera acting, which is sometimes called for because that's what they want on purpose to, you know, be funny or make a joke or whatever, then it's bad, because you're like, well, it's not really happening to you. And you're not maybe consciously as the viewer making this connection, but like you get taken through the scenes and the motions of whatever's happening, whatever you're experiencing, like if you go to see a movie or a play or whatever, because it's real for the actors in that moment. It has to be. So if it's not really happening to me, it's not really happening to you. And the only way I can make it really be happening to me is I have to either have the full context of the story and just like really understand, like I can decide how my character feels about X, Y, and Z if I understand everything that's going on and everything that's happened. And then like that will be processed organically from my brain to my mouth and come out the way where I would react. And like the easiest way I can, like I spent a lot of time with Richard Horvitz, who was Invader Zim. And he always he always explains that like for example, people grieve and mourn in different ways or are angry in different ways. Like your reaction to like, let's just do something really personal. Like the reaction of the death of your mother for you might make you really pissed off, and maybe that's how you manifest mourning, grieving, and anger. You're just pissed off. Some people just curl up and sob and are sad, and that's how they manifest grief. Whatever. But it has to be real for you. You can't arbitrarily pretend to be sad, because that's because it's fake.
Exactly.
So with The Park, Joel Bilas, who's a creative director at Funcom, and that was like his little pet baby project, which by the way, I have to say this every time I mention The Park. The Park was made in 7 months total with like maybe 5 people, one designer, one full-time artist, and one coder, and one audio person. And it was originally just a 3-month R&D project because Funcom wanted to investigate whether or not they should invest in Unreal as an engine. And they were like, you have 3 months to scrap something together. By the way, if we like it, we'll fund it to ship. So I got to be part of like that initial 3-month trial of like, we don't know if this is going to be beyond an R&D internal project. So Joel, his creative director, he was the sole writer on The Park, and his wife is a, I believe, social services psychologist.
Right.
And so when you're social service, you're specializing obviously in like family dynamics and stuff. and he used a lot of her input because, no spoilers at this point, the park is about postpartum depression.
Yeah.
Which is a pretty devastating condition to be in, because for a new mother, you're supposed to automatically be so in love and bond with your child and go through all these things. And if your brain chemical makeup and your body chemistry and your hormones are totally out of whack, it leads in the most devastating depression. And you might not even be able to identify it because you're like, well, everything's fine. Am I supposed to be in love? So you don't think to say, I need help. I think I'm in a depression. I think I might have postpartum. Like now, I think like Brooke Shields 15 plus years ago was the first person of notoriety to say, this is something that I've been through. I had to deal with it. I had to go to a doctor. I had to get medication, da 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 da. So Joel found that all just very, like a very compelling, fascinating backstory. So with his, and I just got to say, like, hail to the chief who listens to his wife. But with like a lot of his wife's input feedback, and I believe Joel also has two daughters, it was all very personal for him.
Okay.
So he was like, how can I turn postpartum as a basis into somebody's personal journey of dealing with all the garbage in their life, and then postpartum on top of that, which is a lot. Yeah. And he had to dump that on me in like 5 minutes before we started recording. Because just like as is tradition with most video games, you don't see the script before you go in. We just go in and we get told. So like the voice actor's job is to be smart and investigative and curious enough to get, if they're not, they being the booth director or the dev or whoever's in there with you, if they're not forthcoming enough with all the story and context and details for you to make an informed opinion, you have to quietly internally decide for yourself what's going on and how you feel. Because if you don't decide, it's fake and it's bad. Okay. So Joel had to like dump on me in like maybe 5 minutes. This is what the game's about, which is heavy. And then also, and interestingly enough, I haven't really thought about this. So Joel's got two daughters, and then Rob King, who was my booth director / sound engineer, because he has a private studio in his home. He has a really young daughter too. So they both kind of like coached me through that whole. And again, like I'm not a mom, so they kind of. I think they were really good litmus tests for me to bounce off of like, am I feeling this deeply enough? You know what I mean? Because I think they would have been more sensitive to that than like, say, if I was recording with like a couple 20-year-old guys or something. Like, someone for whom this is not their life experience.
Yeah, definitely. So, I think it came out well. Like I said, I really enjoyed the park. I got, you know, the deeper connections. I think a lot of people were playing it more as they weren't really following the story. They were trying to play it, like as you said, maybe like as just a normal horror game. Maybe there's something like Outlast or
where are the bodies? Yeah. Where are the zombies? Where are the zombies? This isn't $20 worth of zombies.
So yeah, I definitely think the park was probably one of my favorite pieces of your work. But before we move on, I've got a quick side question. Normally we don't talk about non-video game stuff. Our show's a video game related show. But we have on our show usually a guest. I'm not sure if you know her. Her name's Tasia Valenza. She's been on our show like 4 or 5 times over the 2 years. And she's great. She's Poison Ivy in Batman. You're playing Poison Ivy in DC Super Friends.
Yeah, I got to do that. That was really fun.
Can you tell us how did you get Poison Ivy? I mean, it's a great role, obviously. Not many very many ladies get to play Poison Ivy, so you have a very short selection of like ladies to draw inspiration from. How did you do that? Did you kind of create your own Poison Ivy? Did you take different aspects of other Poison Ivies, and how was it playing Poison Ivy?
So when you get to do a franchise established character, it's a big deal, not just as like, oh, it's such an honor. Like, this is something I grew up, blah, 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 blah. Yeah, fine. That's all part of it. But like working for like Warner Brothers, I mean, my agent made it a point to tell me, she's like, you do know that you had to go past a panel of people, right? Like basically guardians of the franchise who have to approve everybody who like carries a Batman or a Green Lantern or whatever. You have to get past them to get approved to do this. So that's kind of a big deal. So that's like a nice pat on the back for me. I was lucky enough where they just liked my audition and they were just like, do more of that. okay. And it was really surreal for me too, because that was like in my first year of doing VO with an agent through LA, and the sessions were running kind of late. And first of all, it's like you do all Warner Brothers stuff on the lot. So already I'm on the lot, and I like to get to that area, the animation area, you have to walk past it's Sal's Auto, which I forget. There was some Vince Vaughn movie a few years back where they were all like playing used car salesmen. And it's the set from that. So it's already surreal where you're like, I'm walking past movie sets to go do a cartoon. So that's already like, cool. Again, like, you know, a year in, that's bananas. I'm really, really fortunate, knock on wood, I've gotten to do some pretty just stellar stuff very early on. I realize how hashtag blessed I am. So I get in, the sessions are running kind of behind, and so Yuri Lowenthal is waiting to go in before me. And I knew him kind of vaguely, so I just got to be like, hi, yeah, I'm here, I'm doing this, blah, 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 blah. And then so he goes in finally. And then the person who comes in after me is Wally Wingert, who is extremely, I think he was like the voice of for the frickin' Jay Leno's Tonight Show or whatever for years. And he's done just butt tons of everything, of cartoons. Like Wally Wingert is like the Weird Al of VO, because he has the hair. And he's also a collector nerd. And he's just a really, really nice guy. And the sessions were running slowly. I think I sat and chatted with him, I don't know, 20-30 minutes, because he was actually Green Lantern in that series, which is all on YouTube. You can go watch. It was such a ridiculous opportunity for me, because I just got to sit there and basically be a wide-eyed noob and just interview him and ask him questions about, like, what do you think about doing conventions and da-da-da. And he just, like, gave me this really pleasant business talk, because I had him hostage. and then I got to go do Poison Ivy. So that was just, like, a dumb awesome day for me. Warner Brothers was great. They just had me do more of what I did, which also, by the way, so you know how I was talking earlier, like, personally I'll sweat when I see reboots, because I might be, if I'm too attached to what was done, I can't even think of what to do that's new. That's bad, because they don't want more of the same. They don't. That's why they're rebooting it. When whatever new Everything Old Is New Again franchise that you see, they don't necessarily, if they wanted what was done, they'd just keep hiring that person forever till they're dead. But they don't. They want to try something else. So what you got? So me, just being an American, obviously I'm attached to Batman, and Poison Ivy's a favorite. Even Uma Thurman's in that disaster of a movie that we won't mention. Also, like, typecasting, not bad. I've gotten to play so many villains, because, again, not faking it. So, like, all those evil cackles are for real and very satisfying. It was just a really good day. And I think I think Poison Ivy was, like, the first in a series of franchise villains that I've gotten to do. I mean, no spoilers, but there's more coming down the line. And I just, I just have to laugh, because, like, you think... So I think when you're outside of the industry, you might think typecasting is either, again, people who are adorable and think actors actually get to choose their jobs. Be like, well, this actor's only picking this kind of job over and over again. Or casting agents or whatever only picking this actor for this job over and over again. In my, just telling you firsthand, people pick me, unrelated people pick me for the same things. Like, I've been in space so much. Oh, my God. I'm in space a lot. But that's just because whatever I'm into stinks and comes through, and that's who I am. Like, I'm a big nerd. I'm into space. I'm pretty malicious in my day-to-day. I torment my cats. So that stuff just resonates, and that's what they cast me for. And that's good, because they come to – because unrelated people are like, oh, you know what you'd be really good for? It's like, no, tell me, even though I've done it five times this year. And y'all don't know. So, like, when people are like, Troy Baker's in everything, and he's kind of the same thing, it's like, well, that's what people like him for, and that's what he's good at. So, you know, and he can't, like, due to NDA, none of us can tell, hey, did you know that I'm in a bunch of other things that are like this? I'm not going to tell you that. I'm going to take the money and run.
Right. All right. Well, our next question is, oh, my goodness. I'm trying to figure out. Yeah, we'll do this one now. Okay, so we talked a little bit about this earlier, Masquerada. It's a little bit different. Not a whole lot of people kind of know the backstory about how this game was recorded. I do because I actually, as you know, I just interviewed Morla a couple of weeks ago, and we've been trying to kind of show people this game and let people know how this game was recorded because the dialogues are so great. It was an ensemble recording, correct? You were there with some of your other voice cast. Can you tell us a little bit about recording like that?
Of course. So Mike Surix, who goes by a production name Bright Skull, he's a long-standing audio dude. He did a lot. I know he did a lot of recording for BioShock 2 and stuff. And he's been around for a long time. And he's worked with in-house and out-of-house with actors so much, like, he knows the value of ensemble recording. So the significance and importance of ensemble recording when you have more than one actor at a time in the booth. So, yeah. Like, the reason a lot of, as we call them, face actors, like on-camera actors, right. People who do film, television, and it's just like, if you're going to call us a voice actor, you're a face actor.
That's great. I like
stupid that. Face actor. So a lot of face actors get hired as like celebrity stunt casting for whatever, an animated movie, a cartoon, whatever. And they struggle so much because they've never had to act in a void before.
Right.
And when you're a voice actor, you have to imagine the whole thing has to be real, but entirely in your head. So like the scene, the weather, the noise volume that you're having to talk over, how far you are from your people. Like, you don't have any real world perspective to fake that with. It has to be real in your head. You are a 5-year-old playing pretend all by yourself in a black box, like a mental patient. Like, you can't, it has to be real for you, and it can't, and you can't be shy about it. So, face actors, anybody who gets to do anything on a soundstage, on a set, on a theater stage, whatever, you have real faces to read. Like, you can have a conversation where you can read someone's face, so their emotion dictates your emotion and your reaction, blah, 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 blah. So when voice actors actually get to run into each other and do something together, we're all like dogs sniffing each other's butts. You're so excited. It's like, hi, how are you? What are you doing? Oh, you're here. Like, even if we're in passing because our schedules overlap, it's like, hi, how's it going? Because we work alone all day. And then we go home and we audition alone all night. And then we do it again. And that's just like, that's not good for people. It's just not good for humans.
Right.
So Mike was really insistent. And could you tell me, what's the Masquerada's developer's name?
Hold on.
I'm not a good actor. They're a really nice group of people out in Singapore. I remember correctly. Yes. And they just trusted Mike point blank when he was like, you should do ensemble recording. The reason ensemble recording isn't done more, first of all, scheduling is a nightmare.
Yeah, here's I can't pronounce it. It's a Jasper Games.
That works. I don't know. They're nice people in Singapore, and they're really nice and supportive of me and everybody. Like, that cast is enormous, first of all. So with ensemble scheduling is a nightmare. And then you've got people with different pay scales. I've always hear people say that it costs more. I think that's a lie.
That's what
because
I've heard.
I think that's a lie because, well, no, it's a lie. Because at the end of the day, the math is you pay for studio time. If you're recording a bunch of actors at the same time, you pay less for studio time.
That's what
you're not
I was
paying,
thinking. Yeah.
You're not paying per body in the booth. You're paying per half hour, typically. Everybody from the outset, like, my agents didn't negotiate a higher rate because it's ensemble. That's insane. They were just like, no, it's the normal scale pay, so the minimum wage. So I don't know where the more cost comes in. I think that's a lie. But Mike was really insistent on doing it, and we did it. So I got to, in Masquerada, I'm basically Matt Mercer's Uber driver. he's got his wagon, his horse cart, you know, his fa-la-la, carriage, that's the word. And Mike Center Nicholas is my brother, and we basically just look like gender swap versions of each other. Mike Center Nicholas is like, he's adorable. So the first people I ever met while I was still in games and before I was doing VO at all, I met them in a bar in Austin when Austin GDC still existed. And this is like 2008.
Right.
Mike and Stephanie Shea. And we just met them through, I met them through a mutual friend. I was just like, I'm kind of thinking of doing VO, maybe? And Stephanie sent me my first audition, cast me for my first thing. I was an off-brand Dora the Explorer in LA. Like, so they were there before anybody knew me.
Right.
So it was awesome to get to be trapped in a box recording opposite Mike Center Nicholas. And then Matt Mercer, who's like, Matt Mercer like deserves all of the success and love and adulation he gets, because on top of being a great actor, he's an incredibly good, nice guy. Like, yeah, that guy is as wholesome as wheat bread. He's ridiculous. So we did the three of us did a morning session in Mike's booth, and there was a lot of laughing till peeing. We're professionals and we held it together, but you kind of lose your mind a bit. But it was awesomely intense, because I got to be in there, and like, it wasn't my first ensemble. Oh, I lost you for a second. It wasn't my first ensemble session, but it was my first one with Matt. And the thing I kind of didn't like clock off the bat, because we can be there in person, Matt immediately just went into like theater mode.
Yeah, he's
and he would go like, he would look off the page and look me dead in the eyes. Like, no, we're going. You have to meet me now. We're gonna go and do this. Like, it's like actually like theater. And I was like, oh shit. So I had to like up my game, you know, and also like semi memorize lines. No, because you don't get that opportunity in VO ever. Like, the dream for me and for a lot of actors is to get to do like the closest you get to do, in VO to theater performance is mocap, performance capture. Because you're in a wetsuit and little balls on you, but you get to be on a stage with a director. Yeah. You get to have just like real interactions. You're relieved of the weight of it being all in your head. So that's like the ultimate goal. But getting to do that with Matt, who took it very seriously and was just like, no, I'm going to dead-eye you and you're going to act with me. And I was like, shit, we are acting now. That was just a really great experience. And
That's awesome to hear.
I like to think that came out in the game. If you play it, you can just sort of hear it's a lot more naturalistic.
It very much is. It's very apparent that you guys were there in the booth. You can tell because of just how, like, as you said, natural it is. And I think especially with the cast that they put together, Matt Mercer is, he's a great voice actor. He's right up there with Troy Baker, Nolan North. He just doesn't get as much publicity as I think he really deserves, as many games as he's been in. And I have to tell you, when we had him on the show, and he's one of those guys that slips in and out of characters on a whim. And so I've got to imagine he was great to work with. But Morla also was great. And even some of the lesser known voice actors there all have pretty good pedigrees when it comes to, you know, what they've done. And I think that game, as I said, we're trying to share this with as many people as possible. So if you guys are watching the show today and you haven't seen or played Masquerada, go check it out. It's on sale right now on Steam. The developers are really active on Twitter as well, if you want to tweet at them if you have played it. But I love the ensemble recording, and we ask a lot of voice actors when they come on the show, if you rather have the cast that you're recording with there with you, or the script ahead of time. It's so torn, like, right down the middle. A lot of our more energetic and enthusiastic voice actors want the people there, and then some of our more kind of alone, maybe one-off character voice actors that we've had on the show just want the script. So I think it just goes to show, like, you know, the way that this industry is progressing, they can do ensemble recordings. It is possible. It's not, as you said, I don't think it would be as expensive as maybe they're making it out to be. I think maybe the issue is they're scared to do it a different way at this point.
And scheduling really is a nightmare too. And also, like, so like I said, when you've got maybe stunt casting people who are not accustomed to doing VO, you have to massage them and work with them a lot more for stuff like pain and attack emotes and all that sort of thing, because they just can't. They can't conceive of it without doing it on a soundstage.
Yeah.
Which, by the way, that's part of the business for voice actors. Plenty of television shows and film have what's called loop groups, people who just do ADR, additional dialogue recording, where production sound just wasn't great, or the original delivery of an actor's line was just kind of garbage or unintelligible. So they hire someone who's a voice match. So we get auditions for voice matches all the time, where you just redo the actor's line. It's like singing in the rain. And that's part of the business too.
Yeah, Definitely. Well, that game, as I said, is very unique. And if you guys, like I said, have not seen it, go check it out. It's called Masquerada, Song in Shadows. It's a pretty cool game. I haven't beat it all the way through, but I'm having a great time playing it up until this point. So that about ends our kind of regular questions. We've got a couple of Andromeda questions that I kind of spoke to you about earlier. Nothing story or spoiler or gameplay related, but moving into a game like Andromeda, just the massive amounts of fan theories out there and fan shows, and I'm sure you saw some of our tweets to one of our great friends, Mass Effect Odyssey. This is like brand, this IP has so many dedicated fans. Was that intimidating at all coming into Andromeda, or did you have to kind of put that out of the back of your mind and just kind of play it like any other game?
So because, you know, I'm from the games industry, the people who tend to be the loudest and most vocal online are trolls who are not spending time having fun playing the game or being excited, because the people who are in a good mood having fun are busy being in a good mood having fun.
Yeah.
And they don't necessarily think to like send thank you cards, you know what I mean? Because they're like, I got my gift, I'm good. Versus people who are pissed will put a lot of time and energy into hate. Yeah. And developers are certainly on the receiving end of that. So being an actor now, like my mindset has to be, look, I get my ass out of bed, I show up, I have coffee in me, and I'm ready to go. And if I can make peace with, like, I did the best I could every day I was in there for Mass Effect or whatever project, if I did the best I could, then I'm fine, regardless of how other people think about it. I have to be.
Right.
I'm still reading the comments because I'm masochistic and it's fun and you get to see insane stuff. My headspace has to be like, this is the best I could do. I'm sorry if you don't like it, but that really is the best I can offer. I didn't know what to expect exactly with Mass Effect fans. So like Tom and I are not replacing the Shepard Legacy because it's a completely separate game. This is like, I mean, we're like the Rogue One of the Mass Effect universe, right? Like, we're not replacing Luke and Leia and Han. They continue to exist in perpetuity and in whatever fanfic you want to ship.
Yeah.
But we're the Rey and the Poe, you know, we're off in our own little corner of the universe.
Right.
So we at least have the protection of that separation. So we also have like freedom to do what we want. Cause like, I can tell you off the bat, like Shepard ain't nothing like the Ryder family, because they're just not the same people. It's so apples and oranges. I can't even, like, without spoilers, I can't scratch the surface, cause they weren't conceived in the same way at all. And that certainly has been disseminated in, in interviews and press materials, that it's just not the same. So comparing what Tom and I do to what Mir and Hale do would just be weird, because it would be exactly like saying, well, you know, Mark Hamill and Carrie Fisher did this, and like John Boyega What's Her Face did this, and it's just like, you know, it's not the same. Yes, it's not the same. Very good.
That's
nailed
the point.
It.
Yeah, right.
It's not the same. Good job. But Mass Effect fans in general, I was not prepared for the. It's like they're all on ecstasy.
Yeah.
Like a lot of ecstasy. And they're like really where there should be aggro, they just want hugs.
Yeah. It's great too. There's some terrible communities out there. I've been in the video game industry and this interview business for a long time, and I tell you, there are some terrible, terrible communities out there for great games. Mass Effect is the opposite. The community is great. Everybody, even if they disagree, kind of will, you know, try and talk it out. There's lots of, like, as I said earlier, like fan theories. I'm sure you have to have seen at least a couple of theories on the new game character.
I've been watching the YouTube since like E3 stuff. I see them all. I see their little reaction videos and them wearing like their N7 jackets and hats. I see you. I see you, nerds. I just imagine like the Mass Effect community like in a giant massage conga line, because they just seem like those people on the back wall of a convention, right?
Right.
That's just, yeah. So they've been, like really adorable, curious tribbles kind of like poking at me on Twitter and whatever and saying hi. And like, obviously, like, you know, you're the first of the Mass Effect related interviews that I've gotten post announcement. They're just like really, really nice and kind of obsessive in the most loving way. Because my favorite thing now is like, I watch everybody's as many as I can anyway. Like their podcasts and their essentially conspiracy theory videos of speculation.
Right.
I just loved like coming into work and telling my director, I was like, someone made an hour-long video of what they don't know. Just talking about they don't know and what might happen and talking about how they don't know, but this could be a thing.
Yeah.
For an hour. And that's after editing.
Yeah. It's unlike there's only one or two other games that garnered that kind of response. I think Metal Gear is probably one of them. There's a very similar kind of way that fans handle like these announcements when they like when you guys released the trailers for In 7 Day and you guys were announced as the voice actors, everybody immediately starts scouring your IMDb's looking for hidden clues on your Twitter and all of this crazy stuff. And that doesn't really happen for some of these other games. I mean, you've been in some big titles. You were a couple additional voices in Call of Duty. You were in the Technomancer, which was a great game, and I just don't think there's a lot of games out there that have that kind of fan that will just scour over every inch and every frame of a trailer or a little voice clip that you guys do to try and find something. And it's got to be at least a little bit humbling knowing that, you know,
I just want to do right by everybody. Like, I understand how and why they're so precious about... Like, I mean, the way that encapsulated, like, I don't know who to credit, I'm sorry, but I've seen it said at least, like, two or three times of, like, I can't wait to spend so much time with you. And that sounds so creepy. But it's a fair statement to make because you're going to listen to us for hundreds of hours at however long you want to stay in that world. It's us being your mouths. And that is a pretty intimate experience. Like, you can't. It's a little Stockholm syndrome-y, right? Like, you can't come out the other side of that. Like, when you... In the same... Like, there is a reason there is so much freaking Overwatch fan art.
Yeah.
Right? And it's not because artists like the art style. That is inconsequential. People play their characters. They get attached because, like, the character's VO becomes your VO. Their personality becomes your personality. And you start repeating their catchphrases because they're your catchphrases. So you sort of... You insert yourself in the avatar and it creates an emotional attachment, and then you make fan art like a crazy person and fanfic and you buy all the Funkos and whatever and on and on and on. So I'm aware of that responsibility. It is a responsibility, right? Like, well, it's more than a paycheck for sure.
Definitely. So tell me a little bit about, I guess the recording process. Was there a time when you got the call from your agent and said, okay, you're in Mass Effect, that it hit you that you're in a game as big as Mass Effect? Or are you trying...
I'll tell you how it went down. I mean, EA be damned. I don't think this breaks NDA. What happened was everything is codenamed, right? So in games, most scripts are under a dummy name or a dummy script. And like part of the strike interviews back and forth, whatever, I think Keith Farley had mentioned like he was doing Fallout for however many years and didn't know he was on it until it was announced. That's normal. Like, I've done that. Bethesda is pretty specific. I've done that too. Like, I've done games for them where at the session I was like, so what is this? And they're like, we're not telling you. but you'll have an idea when it's announced. And sure enough, it gets announced. I'm like, okay, I know what I'm in. Whereas if something's, you know, been announced via trailer or whatever, they'll feel comfortable letting you know what it is.
Okay.
And to their credit, people leak crap all the time. This is why we can't have nice things.
Yeah.
Like, people will, like, for some reason, will feel really cool about emailing scripts and crap and be like, aren't I cool? I sent it to a website. I'm a hero. No, you're not. You're an idiot.
Yeah.
So we can't have nice things.
I agree.
So with Andromeda, it was just, a dummy script, and agents are like, well, you're going for, you know, codename this project, show up this time at this studio, which is very normal. Like, any other thing, like any other commercial or animated thing or whatever, I know what I'm working on. But games, really commonly, it's just a date and time. You sort of feel like, you know, a spy. You're showing up at a drop-off location.
Right.
Where you drop off your pee.
I'm here for the thing.
Yeah, you drop off your pee from sitting in traffic. And then you go and then you find out, or you try to figure out what you're working on. And then you just do your best. So I just showed up at the date and time and walked in the studio when the client wasn't there. And they're like, we're Skyping in the client. And this is a studio that I work at a lot. And like the engineers are people I've known since I was the client. Like I've recorded when I was a sound designer, I was there co-directing sessions and stuff. So I like knew the engineers. It's just the engineers and me. They Skype in the client. And it was Caroline Livingstone off of Twitter who did the announcements for N7 Day. And she goes, hi, Frida. So welcome. Welcome to Mass Effect. You're the player character. And I was like, what? And it didn't hit. And I'm like, my jaw hit the floor. And I just like look through the glass to the two engineers. And I'm like, and I just start mouthing, what the fuck? And they're just like shrugging like, this is your problem now.
Yeah, right.
We're not helping you with this, whatever. And I was like, okay. Sorry about the lawnmowers outside. Audio problems. And it just didn't. I refused to accept it, where we just like did our first session and just like ran through it like you do, just blah, blah, blah. And I got out and I was like, okay, that wasn't real. And the way my brain processed it was, you know what? This happens all the time. Companies will hire cheaper, lesser known actors just because they need to get something in for testing purposes to see if certain scenes are going to work or dialogue or whatever. I'm temp. I'm totally temp. I misheard. I didn't hear right.
That's the same thing Mark Meer said about his audition for Mass Effect. I think that kind of explains or shows a little bit about how they approach like who their characters are going to be.
Yeah, it just helps with coping. So I was just like, you know what? I misheard. I'm temp because I'm not anybody. So whatever. And I went months through that mentality, and I don't think I started to accept maybe I'm the player character until many sessions in where I'm like, oh, they're not kidding. Oh, crap. Oh, God, it is me. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God. So, like, that goes back to what I was saying earlier. Like, you can't want it, right? Like, if I was the biggest... Like, I have friends who have the frickin', I don't know, like, one of the ships tattooed on her arm, and the other one, like, another girlfriend was going off about on Twitter about, like, I really like N7 jackets, but I don't know why it doesn't have pockets. And I'm like, these are my friends. Crap. You know, never mind, like, making fans happy.
Gotta lie to them now.
No, like, never mind. Well, never mind making fans happy. Like, if my friends hate my work.
Oh, man.
Sure, that's pressure, right? So, like, sitting towards the burst of blah that would be N7 Day was a lot of crap on my shoulders, for sure. Yeah. But, again, like, going back to what I was saying about, like, you can't want it. If I was the biggest Mass Effect fan on Earth, I would think I would be handling it very poorly. I don't think if I'd known what it was and I was a big fan, I wouldn't have gotten past the audition. I think I would crumble in session because when I show up to work, the only thing I'm thinking about is like, I am here to work. Right. I am here to be as committed and present and aware of what I'm performing as possible. And nothing else matters. Not the cat boxes that I have to clean at home, not the groceries I have to go shopping for, not the bill I have to send off. None of that exists. The only thing that exists is the here and now and what I'm doing. And if on top of that, I was adding the pressure of like, quote, doing this right or being a fan, then forget it. Forget it. It'd be garbage. Like you can't think about anything else. It's like being an athlete. If you're, you know, if you're playing a professional level game and you're thinking about the fight you had with your partner, you're probably going to have a crap game.
Right. Definitely. I can see that. I think, you know, when it comes to Mass Effect and, no pressure here. I'm about to be 28. I keep my room like this. This is the only video game poster I have is a Mass Effect poster. So no pressure.
Aww.
No pressure. When you're handling a game like this and you're doing that initial session, and this, by the way, for those of you watching, this is going to be my last main question. So now is like literally the last minute for you to ask your fan questions because we're going to go into those after this. And just so you know, the fan questions are quick one to two sentence answers. We don't have to dive too deep into them because we've got a couple of them. Here and then we'll get out of here. But now's the last chance for you to ask. So if you want to ask a question, ask it here. just remember, no spoiler or gameplay or story related questions for Andromeda. In any case, when you're doing this first session and you're going into the booth and they tell you that, you know, okay, you're playing this character, did you have to do any kind of like searching or tweaking for the voice of Ryder, or is that more or less just your speaking voice? Did they like that? Similar to how Mark Mears isn't very different. It's just a little more, he puts a little more like bravado into his speech, obviously, because he's Commander Shepard. When you're doing Ryder, how was it coming up with how her voice is going to sound?
I think it's just, this is the barest bone answer again to not get me in trouble, but I think I did the actor thing of like, okay, well the base print is me, and then okay, let's build on me. So the main adjustment is like, what would I do if I had Ryder's upbringing and okay, Alec Ryder, Clancy Brown's character, is my father? Like, what would that sound like? Like, based on that kind of upbringing, because, like, you know, I only have my Earth upbringing with my middle class parents, you know, okay, what I mean, like,
right,
so that's
right.
So I sound like this, I talk like this, this is how I react. But what would be different if this is where I grew up and this is who my parents are and this is okay, how they treated me as their child? Like, all those things basically get dialed in and then something else comes out. And I don't, okay, and it's not like, a lot of people think that doing VO is doing voices, right? And the first thing you hear back is actors saying, it's about the acting. Well, they mean it. And yeah, and what that means is just processing all that information so that it comes out in an organic way that is not faked. Because, like, saying, be more angry doesn't mean anything if you don't know why. It just doesn't make sense.
Right, exactly.
Then it's, okay, like, fake
well,
and weird.
I think that's pretty cool, because there's a... We've spoken to some voice actors who, you know, say they go in and they, you know, it's all the director, and, you know, they don't really put too much thought into, you know, what's going on. And it seems like the ones that really have the biggest impact on their game are the ones like you, who take a little bit of more time to understand, you know, their character. Maybe you don't have to dive that deep into every single solitary line, but if you know who your character is and you can kind of like method act as your character rather than voicing a character that you are happening to be playing, I think that obviously can set apart the roles in the game here. So thank you so much for answering those questions. We're gonna go and take a couple of fan questions. The first one we're gonna take is coming off of Twitter. This is coming from, oh, I can't pronounce your name.
It's the internet. Isn't it supposed to be unpronounceable?
We're just going to call you Royalty. It comes from Royalty from Twitter. And he wants to know, when starting to play Mass Effect Andromeda, should he start as male or female writer?
I'm biased. I'm going to play as me.
You're going to play as you?
Well, like, I don't... So, there was a... NPR did a nice interview with Corinne Bailey Ray, who's a singer-songwriter, and she did a bit talking about Prince, how she performed with Prince, and her best memory of Prince was that she was part, I think, of his tour or something. He did, like, a 2.5-hour show, and they had videotaped it. And immediately following the show, he was in his hotel room, and he's like, hey, we're gonna watch. And she's like, you're gonna watch the show? He's like, yeah. He would force himself and his entire entourage, like, the whole band, to sit and watch the 2.5-hour show that they had just done to critique themselves and make themselves, you know, just basically point out what they could have done better.
Right. Okay.
Which sounds insane, but that's why Prince was the best. So my analogy is like, I've never understood actors who are like, oh no, I can't watch the movie or hear the thing I was in. It's too cringy. Well, then you're refusing to learn.
Yeah.
You're actively refusing to learn from your, like, I mean, anybody who's like, for example, a visual artist, this, like, I always say this too, like, if you look at your portfolio 5 years ago, you'll cringe and want to curl up and die and never draw again. And then look at what you can do now, and you're like, man, yeah, I've come a long way in 5 years. But then you get paranoid and think about, oh my God, think of how good I'm going to be 5 years from now, and what I'm doing right now is garbage.
Yeah, definitely.
So, like, well, sorry, Mass Effect fans, what I'm doing right now is garbage compared to what I'm going to do in 5 years. But that's just the natural progress of art.
Right, exactly.
So personally, I'm going to play as cis writer because I want to know what the heck I did and see how all that effort, you know, clicks into the world.
It's got to be also a little bit of that. You've got to, like, wonder, you know, you spend multiple, all these hours for all this time in the booth recording for, you know, what as you said earlier, in a black box or, you know, whatever the case may be, you've got to want to see, like, who you're talking to or what's going on there. I guess at least a little bit, right?
Yeah, I mean, I did my best to feel my feelings in solitaire, and they're pretty good about, like, if stuff isn't already recorded, the director will read with me.
Okay.
So, and like, if you've ever watched Screen Test for film, where, you know, face actors will go in and they'll read off script, and like the producer off camera or someone will sit in the scene with them just so it's a little more real.
Okay.
I get that experience in Andromeda, so it's as real as possible for me. But obviously, like, I want to see how that turned out in context.
All right. Very cool. All right. Our next question comes from Nuke Boy. We kind of already answered this, but I guess you can answer it a little more elaborately. He wants to know, have you ever worked on something other than a video game, like a cartoon, show, movie, short film, etc.? We know you've done Poison Ivy. You were also in Bratz, which is kind of cool. What else did you maybe have under your belt there?
So I always have to go off of IMDb just because that informs me, like, what's been announced. And also, like, I forget, like, people. So people adorably will be like, oh, so you only did, like, five things in 2014. No, those are the five things that actually bothered making it to IMDb. Like,
yeah.
IMDb is not an automated system. IMDb right. is a human being took a screenshot of the credits. And whoever happens to be in that screenshot might get manually updated to IMDb. It's not a full representation of anybody's right. body of work.
Exactly.
So there's what's up there, and then on top of that, I've gotten to do like there's a if you go to my website, nobody tells me when things are out. By the way, like it's the actor's job to go. No, nobody tells you. It's the actor's job to go YouTubing and Googling and whatever to see. I wonder if that thing that I did is out yet, and then posting it and taking credit for it.
I really should email you guys, like, on the release date, hey, this project is out.
Nah, I mean, I get it. We're just service providers, though. Like, we're not, you know, like, no. So I've talked about this with friends. Like, I have a friend who's, like, really into old-timey radio and old-timey commercials. And back in the day when radio kind of mattered in that sense, like, it would be, the Afternoon Philharmonic is brought to you by Fred Soaps. I'm Will Whitaker. Talk to you about Fred Soaps. Like, it was very, the presenter
yeah.
doing the commercial mattered as a personality. But, like, I did a campaign for Proactive, and they're not like, I'm Frieda Wolf for Proactive. Who is Frieda Wolf? No one cares. I'm here to present Proactive. So, like, I've done, like, a few spots for Proactive, and, like, I did over the summer, I got to do a lot of, tags for promo for Sundance Channel. They had a British show called The A Word, which is about an autistic kid and the family and how that affects the family. It's like a dark comedy, and I just got to do all the tags of, like, The A Word next Wednesday at 10 only on Sundance Channel. And those little jobs are lucrative because there's so many of them, because every time there's a switch, like, people don't think, but, like, every time you watch, like, a reality show and they're like, last time on New Jersey Housewives, whatever,
yeah,
that's a job right there. Like, that particular session, blah blah blah. So I've gotten to do some of that, and that stuff doesn't make it to IMDb. Commercial work doesn't make it to IMDb.
Of course. Well, I mean, being in a commercial, it's obvious it's got to be a little different. I mean, now with the way that games are presented, and they're wanting to be more like movies, they're wanting to tell these stories. The voice actors are becoming more than, as you said, a service provider. Maybe that's where you guys are right now. But shows like ours and the coverage that people are doing of the voice actors for games nowadays, it's obvious. Is it inspiring to you to see that some people are starting to care, as opposed to maybe back in the day, as you said, where you were an audio producer back in the late 2000s, where probably nobody cared?
It's nice, but personally, I don't. So I do stuff like do an interview with you today on a weekend when I'm not working, because this doesn't detract from work. I do it because it's fun for me. But I didn't become a voice actor because I'm like, oh my God, I can't wait to do community interviews. That's a weird, goal chase, right?
Yeah, definitely.
So, like, for me, falling into VO, it's like, what can I do that will pay my rent that I find enjoyable? Like, any job should be, what can you do that will provide for your living, but also you don't hate doing for years at a time?
Okay.
That will take care of you as much as you take care of it.
Makes sense.
And then, like, you know, when you're a creative or an artist, you have to find some balance in there, because very often you find yourself doing commercial art. So, like, if if you're an artist, but you work for Disney, Warner Brothers, DreamWorks, or whatever, you are a commercial artist. You are, or if you're a video game developer, you are a commercial artist, because you are there to fulfill someone else's vision and bring their direction to fruition. This is not your influence. These are not your ideas. Fine art is what you do in your own time.
Okay.
So me coming from development, I definitely have the headset of a commercial artist. I think I'm good at bringing other people's ideas to fruition, and I enjoy it. So VO is just like an extension of that. So the fulfilling part is me making a client happy because my ideas of, you know, orally sketching out what they wanted brought to life the thing that they were hoping I could do. You know what I mean? So like in the same way where, like, also, like, my analogy for this is, like, when you hire a concept artist and you're like, draw me a frog, anybody can draw a freaking frog, but you hire a particular concept artist because you're like, no, I want your frog. I want your vision for a frog, because your vision for a frog is going to be cool and rad and different because I've seen your other stuff. I want you to do it because I want your frog. And you have to, so you have to have, when you're a commercial artist, you have to have that mindset for everything. It's like, you're not there to do a literal biologically accurate depiction of frog, because that's freaking boring and anybody could do that and it's not worth the money of the thing that you bring. So VO is no different. So it's like the louder I am about being who I am at my base without trying to please anybody else first, the more I work, because I'm bringing the thing that nobody else can do because they're not me. Versus if you're trying to do what everybody else can do, you get lost in the sea. Like, every audition that goes out in LA, at least 200, 250 people are auditioning. And those are just the ones that are around. Gotcha. Versus, like, you know, if not everybody was sick or on vacation or working that day, then you'd probably have, like, a good 500 auditions pouring in for a female character.
Right.
So...
Our next question comes from Clan of Cats. He wants to know, or she, I don't know, can be, wants to know, how do you approach an established character versus a character with more of a blank slate? I guess a good point would maybe be like Poison Ivy versus Ryder.
So Poison Ivy, they liked what I did, and that's why they hired me. So they just encouraged me to do more of that, which is a nice leniency. And then, like, Ryder being brand spanking new. It's the frog thing again. It's like, okay, well, we know you can be a human female. What kind of human female can you be? You, the person that we hired that are in the booth today versus any other human female. In my head, I'm always like, do I want to be, I don't know. I waffle between, like, my two of my acting idols, honestly, Jared Harris, Richard Harris's son. So, like, original Dumbledore son, Jared Harris. You've seen him in everything and you don't know who he is because he disappears. He disappears like butter into his roles, and he has like a not memorable face, and his acting is so freaking good that he makes a tremendous impact in everything he is. And you've seen him in 70 things, but you just don't remember. You don't remember that it's Jared Harris the way you remember that it's Brad Pitt.
Gotcha.
So he just like melts into his roles, and I think that's a huge compliment. And then my other acting idol, no shit, Danny Trejo, because Danny Trejo gets hired to be Danny Trejo. And he is the best Danny Trejo that ever was a Danny Trejo. And you can't hire, if you want Danny Trejo, if you hire someone else to be like Danny Trejo, you're not going to get Danny Trejo. So it's I've been made well aware that pretty often I get hired.
That's a great analogy.
But it's the truth, because they don't want something. They'll say something like, but then they just end up hiring the person who is the thing.
Right. Okay.
So it's been made known to me that I get hired to be the person who is that thing because I'm very loudly me. I'm not here to be like a blank slate for you to paint your vision on. I'm here to give you my goddamn frog.
Gotcha.
Because I think it's the best frog that I can do versus someone else's frog.
All right. Our next question comes from LR33. And you might not be able to answer this one. Maybe you can. I don't know. They want to know, and just so we can put it in context, we have seen your character, Ryder, in the trailers and cutscenes. We've seen Tom's character's Ryder as well. They want to know, was the default, the way that they look there in those cutscenes and the pictures that we've seen, is that based on your guys' faces, or was that created before you guys got there?
Yeah, to my knowledge, if anybody used our heads, it was not... we were not told, but I do believe I'm repeating what other fan sites have said. Some model on Instagram posted something about, I'm really excited to be a part of this game. and she sort of like in a disconnected way. I'm so excited to be a part of Andromeda. And she looks like cis writer, so maybe it's her. I don't know. Like, I saw some fan site post that, okay, were like, ooh, a lead. And then for me, too, I'm like, ooh, a lead.
Okay.
I don't know.
All right, so to your knowledge, it's not particularly based off you. Just maybe happens to resemble you a little bit. There's a little bit of a resemblance there. I'd have to look more at it.
This is why, like, asking me anything about the game is futile anyway, because anything that's a surprise to you is also a surprise to me. I'm learning with you.
Right. All right, so our last question, I saved this one for last because it's kind of funny. This one comes again from Nuke Boy, and he wants to know, who is the bigger nerd, you or Tom?
Oh, God, I don't want to fight. I don't know. Tom, so I'm really happy to get to share this project with Tom because we're both dorks and like big nerds, and Tom is the biggest Mass Effect fan, and like he just devours. He picks up where I leave off because he devours RPGs and like basically a lot of the games that I don't like, and I do all the shooty hack and slash murder games that he doesn't like. Man, I don't know. Well, I get instant nerd street cred just because I came from development,
right?
But he's probably played more tabletop than me. He's probably been invited back to D&D more than me, because I don't try to like murder all the taverns people and the peasants because I want to know what they're carrying more than what their backstory is. I don't care that you're an orphan. What are you holding?
Okay.
Yeah. So I don't know. I don't know who would win in a nerd off. Probably, I would just say Tom. Probably. I'm definitely
barely,
more. I think,
but barely.
But barely. Like, okay. I have default nerd cred, but also like I think I'm more of a pop culture geek. Like I'm movie obsessed. Like I am the dork who, like, as soon as the movie's over, I got to pull up the IMDb trivia and memorize everything.
Definitely.
Just for my own personal safety.
Okay. Well, I've got a question then for you before we let you go. We're at the end of the interview here. We're no more real questions. But if I talk to Tom, is it possible that I can get you and Tom on the show after the game's out to talk about some of the stuff within the game?
Potentially, we take our orders from Baby Daddy EA, and whatever Baby Daddy EA says goes. So it's up to EA. Like I'm sure we'll put it out there either way what EA says.
Well, I don't mean now. I mean like next year when the game's released and people have had a chance to play it. Would you be willing to come on the show with Tom?
My willingness has very little to do with what EA wants. Believe me.
Okay.
So
if EA
says okay, yeah, sure. Okay. Yeah, I mean, I would love to. I know Tom would love to. It's just a matter of EA giving us permission to take the keys to the car and drive it into a wall.
No, definitely nothing like that. Last year, we had Brian Delaney and Courtney Taylor, the stars, the kind of like you guys for Fallout, though. They the male and female lead for Fallout. We had them on the show after Fallout was over. We ended up clearing that with Bethesda because we have PR contacts there. So I can get in contact with EA and clear for after the game's launch. I just wanted to know if you would be willing. Some people don't like to do dual interviews like together or anything like that.
No, I'm happy to.
Okay,
like,
cool.
Tom knows that I talk too much and that I kind of dominate. So he'll have to stand his ground. I'm sure he'll just like babysit me. You know what? I need to know who came out first. That's something I'm going to bug Mike Gamble and Mac Walters after the show. I need to know who came out first so I can establish my dominance if I'm like a second older or something.
Right. That's important.
I need to know now. That's very important. That's canon, man.
Okay.
That's birth canon.
birth canon. Well, yeah. Once the game's out, we'll be excited. We'll ask you. I'm sure if he tells you, you might not be able to tell us right away. But once the game is out and people have had a chance to play, we'll figure it out as fans. We'll ask you who was born first. We'll check with Tom and see if he's interested in doing that, and we'll get with our contact at EA and see if they'll approve that. I'm sure they will if the game's already out. But we'll just double check, like you said, for clarity, and hopefully we can have both. I think that would be really cool to have the brother and sister writers on here at the same time. Maybe you guys can tell some comparing and contrasting stories about your recording sessions and stuff like that once everybody's had a chance to get a feel for the game. So
yeah, let's do it.
With that said, again, thank you so much for this extended interview. It's a little longer than normal. I'm sure the fans enjoyed it. There's a lot of people here today, so thank you guys for watching. Before we go, we told you before the show started that we were going to have you do a character voice. I liked your original idea of you just doing your regular voice.
Oh,
I think that it's up to you. I like the Lorraine from the park. I think she's great. But if you want to do your regular voice, that's fine. Our lines are, this is, if you're going to do Lorraine, you can say, this is Lorraine, and you're watching the codec. Or if you'd like to do yourself, you can say, this is Miss Wolf, and you're watching the codec.
I can do both. Check out how versatile I am. I can do two characters.
Oh my.
That's my max.
Endless talent.
I can do talent. Danny Trejo 1 and 2. He sells tacos now in LA. He is very versatile. He opened up Trejo's Tacos, and I can't wait to go.
That's
because
a great name.
Because he hangs out, apparently, and his face is on the sign. That's the most LA story you'll ever hear.
Okay. Well, I'll be quiet so we can get this for you.
Okay, ready. I'll rapid fire the two of them.
All right.
Okay. Hey, I'm Frida Wolf, and this is the codec. Hey, I'm Lorraine, and this is the codec. Callum!
That was awesome. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.
You're so welcome. Before we go, can you let the audience watching here live and post here on YouTube know where they can follow you, where they can kind of keep up to date on things that you might be doing, that kind of stuff? I know you have a website, and your Twitter account is over here, down here, guys, if you want to follow her on Twitter. Can you tell us what your website is, and if you do like Facebook, anything like that?
It's all my name. I'm not on Facebook, but I am on Twitter. It's just my name, FRYDAWOLFF at Twitter. And on there, I link to my website, which is just my name, fridawolf.com.
Awesome. Thank you again so much for joining us. Have a great rest of the week, and hopefully you'll have a lot more of these community interviews coming up. I know you've got one scheduled coming up with Mass Effect Odyssey, so if you need to listen to more of Frida, you can check her out on those. Follow her on Twitter. She tweets when she's going to be at these particular events and places and things like that. And congratulations on landing that role in Mass Effect Andromeda. We can't wait to next year so we can play it, and we'll be in touch.
Thanks so much. Can't wait for you to spend way too many hours with me in personal intimacy where there is no escape.
Have a great rest of the day. We'll talk to you soon.
Bye.
Bye. All right, ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our extended interview with the lead of Mass Effect Andromeda, exclusively the first interview with the Mass Effect lead from Andromeda here on Hitbox.tv. Really hope you guys enjoyed this show. I enjoyed producing it for you guys. Had a lot of fun talking to Miss Wolf. Had a lot of fun answering some of the questions that you guys had here in the chat. You guys were amazing today. Please give this stream a follow or a like or a share if you would like to support us. There are several ways you can do so. There is a PayPal link in the chat. It is www.paypal.me/thecodec, where you can donate to us directly. You can subscribe to our channel for subscriber emotes, badges, exclusive interviews, things of that nature. We appreciate anything you guys do, but if you don't have any money and you don't want to do that, the best way that you can support us is to share our stream. Bring more people in here. Take this link, send it to somebody, let them send it to a friend. That really is what kind of helps grow and support our show. Big thank you to the Hitbox staff for the front page support and for being sponsors of the codec. We really do appreciate that. We are going to not be here next week at our normal time, okay? I'm going to explain this to you real quick. There's going to be more posts and information on Twitter, which you can follow us at @_codec down below. But next week, I'm actually going to be in Tokyo doing a live stream with Rika Morinaka, composer of Metal Gear Solid and Silent Hill, as she works on her new VR drifting game. I'm going to be doing a live stream from the convention center there, showing you guys some of the coolest VR tech that I've seen to date. And we're going to have an exclusive interview with Rika right there. We're going to be live on Facebook, so you can follow us at Frag Nation or at Nation Fusion on Facebook. There'll be, as I said, some more links down low on Twitter. You can check us out then. If you guys have any other questions for us, or you have suggestions on who you'd like to see on the show next, you can also tweet those at us. I read and respond to every single tweet that comes our way. Thank you so much to the Mass Effect community for showing up. I hope you guys enjoyed this interview with Miss Frida Wolf. And we cannot wait to see you guys next time. And we'll have some more voice actor interviews coming up shortly. Have a great day, and we'll see you guys next week on the codec.